My name is Barry MacLean, and I have the privilege of beginning this, the 20th anniversary conference of the MacLean Center. And I thought I'd start by telling you a little bit about my mother, this amazing woman who was introduced in 1984 by Stan Goldblatt to Mark Siegler. When I saw it, Stan Goldblatt's going out to the washroom, I think, so he won't hear this. But in any case, Mother had had an unsuccessful procedure, and I'll give you the technical name. It's an aorta femoral bypass at a hospital here in Chicago, and it didn't go very well. And as an interested person about my mother's health and knowing the pain that she was enduring, I sought counsel. So I went to a friend, a trusted friend and great friend in Stan Goldblatt, and he said, well, she ought to meet Mark Siegler. So that was back in 1984 approximately, and my brother David is here. But perhaps, Dave, you can give me a better date, if I think that's correct. He says 86. I think it's 84. But in any case, what happened was that Mark and my mother became engaged in what, and obviously following various tests, and what might be done to help her condition. And ultimately, the University of Chicago re-performed that operation, much to the success of my mother. And obviously, during that process, they shared lots of ideas about outcomes-based information. There developed a doctor-patient relationship of consequence. Mark became a great friend of my mother. My mother became a great friend of Mark's, very genuine. My mother became a great friend of the surgeon, Chris Zarens, who, how many people remember Chris Zarens here at the university? And they teamed up to tell my mother, outcomes-based information says you should stop smoking at the age of 85 years old, and so she did. And that's because the data you presented to her and the information, and she believed you. So it's been really an extraordinary experience for my mother to have known Mark and then Chris and lots of other people in this room and elsewhere, and then to start this conference, which she believed in the whole idea of knowledge, of sharing knowledge with one another, of the advancement of science or the world around us through knowledge. She was a person who believed in knowledge for knowledge's sake. She constantly was reading, writing. Even in her later years, she would write papers. She was a very gifted woman who graduated from high school at 16 or 17 and received a graduate degree from Smith in English at the age of 20. And so she met my father, who was a student nearby Yale, and he was the same age, and he graduated with an undergraduate degree in engineering the same year my mother graduated with a master's degree in English. So she was a learned woman who believed in knowledge, seeking knowledge all her life. And somehow I think today she's watching us and watching the achievements of what she's helped to create, both through the conference and then the family endorsement of the MacLean Center. So it's really been a privilege for our family to be involved and to have known Mark and encourage Mark and try to help Mark on some things we're pretty good at too. And with that said, I'd like to do is to introduce my brother who's here from Virginia and his wife, Carol. David, can you raise your hand? And then we have his son, Jimmy, Jim, and Corinne MacLean, if you'll wave your hands. So the first, as best we can interpret it, the first student of the MacLean Center was in 1984. So that was 24 years ago. That first graduation took place 23 years ago. And since then, no less than 240 individuals have graduated through this program and have gone on to be faculty members and hospital administrators and people who are affecting the lives of a much larger population all over the world. And so it's with that we start this conference officially, and Lenny Ross is next.
Thank you. I want to thank Barry and Marianne MacLean, the MacLean board, and everyone else who has supported us to this date. I also want to thank the two guys who kicked me to get this conference organized, John Lantos and Peter Singer. I wanted to start the conference by taking a look at Mark's influence at 20,000 feet, and then we'll move from the big picture to some of the smaller pictures by looking at some of these papers. But let's start at 20,000 feet.
7-month-old Joshua Skidmore is in Chicago this evening for a second chance at life following a dramatic mid-air rescue on board a jetliner. Joshua is seriously ill. He needs a liver transplant. He was being flown to Chicago from his home in Mississippi on Tuesday when he went into respiratory failure. And Marianne Childress is here to pick up the story.
Floyd, little Joshua is in critical condition at Weiler Children's Hospital. He has neonatal hepatitis, a condition that causes liver failure. He needs a liver transplant to survive, and that's why he's here in Chicago. But this story is about his trip here, which became a literal fight for life. Doctors are optimistic that 7-month-old Joshua Skidmore will be a candidate for a liver transplant. Although he's very sick, he has a fighting chance, thanks to the heroic efforts of a Chicago doctor aboard a Delta jet, somewhere in the skies over Kentucky last Tuesday night. The Skidmores were bringing their son here to the University of Chicago. They were on an 11:45 p.m. flight out of Atlanta. The plane had just reached cruising altitude when little Joshua went into respiratory failure.
I jumped up out of the seat and went and got the stewardess. Told him he was having trouble with the baby breathing. So she immediately ran forward and said, "Is there a doctor on board?"
Dr. Mark Siegler answered the call. He heads the Center for Clinical Medical Ethics at the University of Chicago and had taken the flight at the last minute after a speaking engagement in Georgia.
Here was a situation where flying up in an airplane with a baby not breathing, there was no technology available. We opened the medical kit, but there was nothing there that could be used for the infant.
Although the baby still had a pulse and heartbeat, he'd stopped breathing. So for the next 24 minutes, Dr. Siegler performed mouth-to-mouth resuscitation while the plane headed for an emergency landing in Louisville, Kentucky.
It was the most basic intervention, which is the traditional intervention that's been known since classical times, and that's the breath of life.
By the time the plane touched down, little Joshua was breathing on his own.
The first time we got a cry out of the baby after a couple of 3 minutes of this mouth-to-mouth resuscitation, the mother and I looked at each other and we knew we were on the right track. It was the best cry I had ever heard from a baby.
He said he wasn't really supposed to be on that plane. I said, "Yes, you was." I said, "You may not have known you were supposed to be on there, but God had you on there for us."
Little Joshua was rushed to Children's Hospital in Louisville, where his condition was stabilized. And yesterday, he was flown by air ambulance here to Chicago. Doctors say that he's now in end-stage liver failure, but they're very optimistic about his condition and his chances of undergoing transplant surgery.
Sometimes pictures say it all. To stay on the theme of 20,000 feet, we also... Ella Dutton, who's Mark's RA this year, has spent a couple of hours locating all of us around the globe. And here are all 240 former fellows, visiting faculty, and where they're currently located. So during the breaks, come up and enjoy where we all are, a world global view of Mark's influence. Our goal today is, though, to just move from that global view and to come back to Earth and to do a bit of reminiscing, as well as to give you an update about the MacLean Center and where we are 20 years later. Our goal is to examine really twofold. First, how Mark has influenced clinical ethics, and number two, how Mark has influenced all of us. And then finally, we will talk about where we are going to go in the next two decades. So on that, what I'd like to do then is to introduce the first speakers who will talk about the MacLean Center at its inception. And our first speaker will actually be Dr. Al Tarloff. From September 1999 until July 2005, Dr. Tarloff served as director of the Multi-University Texas Program for Society and Health in Houston, Texas, where he was also professor in the University of Texas School of Public Health and the Sid Richardson and Taylor and Robert H. Ray Senior Fellow in Health Policy at the James A. Baker III Institute for Public Policy at Rice University. He has now returned to Chicago, where he previously served as professor and chairman of the Department of Medicine at the University of Chicago from 1968 until 1981. He's also been elected to membership in the Association of American Physicians and to the Institute of Medicine. And if I were to go on and on about Dr. Tarloff, we wouldn't actually get back to Mark. So I'll stop there and please ask Al Tarloff to join us.
Thank you, Rainey. In 1968, when Mark Siegler
was in his second year of post-MD training as a resident in Chicago here. I became chairman of the Department of Medicine at that time. So I want to cover this morning those years, initial years for Mark here, from 1968 to 1982. The Department of Medicine over its first 40 years became nearly 100% subspecialized in internal medicine in its organization, its faculty composition, its outpatient operation, its inpatient bed assignments, and in its teaching. The extinction of the generalist internal medicine orientation, particularly for medical students, was thought to have a detrimental effect on their education. We at that time envisioned a striking a new generalist subspecialist balance in the department's activities. We created a new section of general internal medicine, a specifically designated general internal medicine outpatient clinic was opened at that time. We reassigned the department's 200 plus beds to carve out 36 beds for general internal medicine on what then was W5. We envisioned then recruiting from outside and developing from within a new faculty having maximal potential to grow as superb practicing academic internists and teachers in the mold of some of the most distinguished clinicians of prior generations, including McGee Harvey at Johns Hopkins, Robert Lerb at Columbia, and which was exemplified institutionally in the reputation and clinical excellence of the British medical care system of medical education. Our first recruit, Dick Binney, who's sitting in the second row here, was a product of the Columbia University system and a student of Grant Little at Vanderbilt University. He arrived here in 1971. He was and is a superb clinician teacher. He assumed the directorship of general internal medicine here. And in that way came into contact with Mark Siegler. The year before Dick arrived, Mark had finished his residency training and was selected as the chief resident in medicine for 1970-71. Mark, as a resident, had demonstrated extraordinary skills as a teacher, a clinician, a leader, and a humanist. I attributed at that time Mark's notable humanistic instincts to his attendance at religious school in his childhood and in his adolescence, and to his majoring in English literature at Princeton. This is a much too simplistic explanation, of course, but it was good enough to secure an entry-level faculty position for him. And until recently, I believed that. We wanted Mark for our faculty in general internal medicine. During his chief residency year, we talked about his future and the desirability of him building on his clinical strengths to further develop as a teaching clinician. Now, I would say that in those conversations, I heard a lot of really unusual stories about his plans for his future. And they were, I'd say, unusual. I say that kindly because they were really off the wall and weird. But at any rate, we obtained funding for him so that he could take his first year at the great Hammersmith Royal Postgraduate Hospital in London, which was 1971-72. Upon his return to the university in July 72, shortly after Dick Binney also arrived here, he joined a new section of general internal medicine. While Dick became director of house staff training for the Department of Medicine, Mark became director of medical student education. Mark also became director of a newly created three-bed intensive care unit on W5, carved out from three rooms up there with a connection being made to all of them. It was one of the first ICUs in the city. Looking back on it now, it was a nightmare because there was no, the modern equipment that we all take for granted wasn't available at that time. But at any rate, for Mark, being the attending physician on the outpatient, in the outpatient department, but also on the inpatient general medicine service for 8 months a year, and being attending on the ICU and director of it, but attending 4 months a year, and in addition, practicing, building a large practice in the outpatient department, Mark was totally and completely immersed in patient care and teaching. The clinical work and teaching was decisively influential on him, on every dimension of his professional interest and affect. He became a consummate clinician, which then and today sowed the seeds of his every thought about the ethics of patient care. In the ICU, he asked penetrating questions about who shall live, who shall die, on what grounds can a decision be made as to which waiting patient gets the next precious bed in the ICU? What are the essential features of a productive doctor-patient relationship? And how do you touch them? How do you teach them? How do you impart them to students and others? A lifetime career in clinical ethics was conceived and born from his natural instincts for empathy, respect for others, regardless of their station in life, a sense of fairness, a hope for justice, and a continuous, joyous pursuit of discovery of new ways of serving human health. All of that stems from his openness to questions from patients, families, nurses, doctors, other faculty, clergy, and others. Mark perceived the need to learn more about the theories of the academic fields neighboring ethics, such as theology, philosophy, and law. He reached out from the medical school to the broader university community and formed collegial relationships. Indeed, these were tutorials. This was an incredible thing. This was a faculty-to-faculty tutorial system that he developed with Professor James Gustafson, Stephen Toulmin, Father Richard McCormick, and many others. Good fortune came Mark's way in the summer of 1975, when he was accepted into a six-week seminar underwritten by the National Endowment for the Humanities, held at Williams College, titled Humanities for the Medical Practitioner. The seminar organizer and leader was William May, who is here in the audience and will speak later this afternoon. While at the seminar, Mark learned that his first paper was titled Pascal's Wager and the Hanging of Crepe. Now, I can tell you that being at that time, I was relatively young too, but I had read by that time a medical literature for 15 years, and I had a high regard for the New England Journal of Medicine. And when I saw the title of that paper, I cringed and thought, this is no time for joking, Mark. And but they liked it at the journal. It was accepted for publication in the New England Journal of Medicine. The paper is a classic, in my opinion. It sought answers to a question that was germinated in the ICU. How should a physician talk with a family about the prospects for living of a loved one who is at death's door? Pascal was followed in the next few years by seminal papers. In 1978, on teaching clinical ethics at the bedside. In 1979, on the limits of clinical medicine. In 1981, on revision of the doctor-patient encounter. In 1982, on confidentiality and discourse with patients. Each of those five papers early in his career are going to be discussed here today and tomorrow. Each has been drawn from Mark's experiences in the ICU and on the wards elsewhere in the hospital and on clinical ethics consultation rounds, which were discovered, which were invented here, first developed by Mark and now frequently seen in other teaching hospitals, but they have become a linchpin, making ethics deliberations common throughout the entire medical center. Well, to sum up my view of things, Mark's astonishing development, adolescents have converted the word awesome to a cliche. So I gave up using it about a decade ago, but I want to use it today. I have been truly awestruck with the growth and accomplishments of Mark Siegler. To put it in academic currency, can you imagine going from an instructor having a truly bizarre plan for his life, or even no plan at all, to a failed attempt to gain tenure earlier in his career, to Dorothy Jean MacLean's vision of a center to improve the quality and outcomes of doctor-patient relationships, then on to being named the Lindy Bergman Distinguished Service Professor at the University of Chicago, forward to being appointed to the Board of Trustees of Princeton University, and then last year to receive perhaps the highest honor that can be bestowed on a member of the faculty of the University of Chicago, being selected as a 2007 Nora and Edward Ryerson lecturer. Awesome, indeed. Thank you.
It's now my great pleasure and privilege to introduce Ann Dudley Goldblatt, who's been a faculty member at the MacLean Center for Clinical Medical Ethics since its inception. She has taught health law to virtually all 240 fellows of the MacLean Center, including half a dozen lawyer fellows who now hold academic and non-academic positions around the country. Ann Dudley received her law degree from Harvard and her LLM from the University of Chicago. She is also a member with her husband Stan of the MacLean Center Advisory Board. Ann Dudley.
Gee, Mark, are you sure you're still alive? That sounded like a eulogy. It was so good. I, I'm going to go over some of the same ground, but in a slightly different vein. Mark was sent to England after his medical school here, in large part by Al, because he was thought to need seasoning. I didn't know what that meant, but now maybe it was the weird life plan. Anyway, he returned, and I met him soon after his return. He returned with a Springer Spaniel named Swift, about to have a pair of twins, a brace of guns, and I am not making this up, a heavy tweed shooting suit that included knickerbockers for going through the gorse to get the grouse. Actually, I believe that his eternal interest in organ transplantation comes from the fact that right after I met him, his dear Swift had end-stage renal disease, and his desperate attempts to keep Swift alive, hairless at this point, were unsuccessful, I'm afraid. But he was a little bit misinformed because he thought the new way of the University of Chicago was if you were a really good clinician and a really good teacher, you didn't have to worry about this research and publishing and grant stuff. That was a mistake. So he opens the ICU, the med ICU, and gets incredibly depressed because they all died. And it was not a happy physician-patient relationship, which even then he was very concerned with. At that time, Chase Kimball had just come to the university in the psychiatry department, and when Mark said, you know, this is a downer, and I need some help in this area, he said, look, we have this guy, Jim Gustafson, just come here from Yale. He has taught virtually every medical ethicist that exists. This is in the early. And now, they were mostly theologians at that point, but they were all very well trained. So Mark goes to Jim, and they create a seminar, as Al said, weekly. You did cases, you read, you did this, you met Stephen Toulmin, and Jim Gustafson also gave him two waifs, Martin Cook and me. So these are two people I've been mentoring, and they're interested in what you're interested in. And so take them, like maybe take them off my hands, I don't know what it was. So that was the first time we had clinical ethics program, what, about 74, 75? And we would go onto the floor, and Mark would find cases. Now, this was a hard time, because if you remember, in the middle 70s, everybody was tough, doctors, especially the women, and they never saw ethical conflicts. So we had to pull conflicts out of the air. Of course, they were there, and all of that. And at the same time, Mark wrote, this is about 1975, wrote the Pascal's Wager. That was the theological part. And the other part was this radical idea that maybe it would be better to be honest with patients. You could actually prognosticate realistically and create a collegial relationship with them. That was the beginning, I think, of what Mark has maintained throughout his career, this total attention and regard for the relationship between doctor and patient, and its really unique fiduciary capacity. About this time, he was going for tenure. Do you go for tenure? He was applying for tenure. He was requesting tenure. He was hoping and praying for tenure. And he'd had one paper and one grant, the very first grant that the Department of Health and Human Services, whatever it was called then, had given to him, but it wasn't enough. And this is a remark that he said to me about 3 months ago, so he has it verbatim. He was called into the dean's office. This was soon after Dan Tassison was seduced and sent, seduced and went to Harvard, and Bob Uritz was taking over the deanship. And Mark went into Dean Yuritz's office waiting for his tenure acceptance. And Dean Yuritz's first words to him is, "Mark, it's been wonderful having you here at the hospital." This was not what he wanted to hear. So both Mark and his friends, which included at this point my husband and myself and many others, Neil Harris, just a whole bunch of people, were very upset that maybe this wonderful clinician, this wonderful teacher, wasn't going to get tenure. But luckily, the next year, you got it. I don't know how that happened and really don't want to know. It's like making sausages. Don't want to know that. And he goes to Williams. And still, except for Dr. Pellegrino, we were still dealing in medical ethics. There was no such thing as clinical medical ethics. It was medical ethics. It was almost all policy. And it was primarily theologians and philosophers, and a few like Leon Cassa were either both or we're not quite sure what. But there were very few clinicians involved. But Mark was already involved in that, and he came back, and something wonderful happened to him. DJ fell for him. He fell for DJ. Both of those are very easy to do. And he got a muse. The best kind of muse, a muse with money. And she said, "You need to expand your scope, not just your patients, but other people's patients." And that was really the beginning. In the very beginning, the Ethics Center was all faculty. We used to have these lunches in the little conference room at the entrance to the brain research. And they were wonderful. I mean, they were, but it was quite clear that we were all preaching to the converted there. We were all together. So, and thank goodness for DJ said, just a few people. Well, a few people he got in the beginning, I hope some of them are here, Abigail Suger, Steve Miles, John Lantos, John LaPuma, Peter Singer. I mean, these have become major elements in the field. And it was a little informal for a while. And this is basically where I get to stop, because is it Lainey who's going to do it? Joe. Okay. We started getting much more organized. Carol was here. John Lantos was already here. Steve Miles was here. Steve Miles, by the way, was the first person at the University of Chicago to take maternity leave. I mean, that's so we knew we had something special going. He has continued on for the past 25 years now, emphasizing two things. One, real cases. That's the Steve Toulmin side of him, and maybe a little bit of me, I hope, but very casuistic approach. Stay dedicated to real things. Policy will come out. So it's a very deontological approach. No, it isn't. It's the other one. But anyway. Yeah? Okay, yes, right. Well, it's certainly casuistic. And then the second is this continued absolute dedication to the doctor-patient relationship, to honesty and collegiality. Now, honesty and collegiality, there is, dare I say it, a paternalistic element in Mark's medical approach. But it is a familial paternalism that is open, if not to reproach, at least, or rapprochement, at least to a negotiation. Mark has consistently attempted to follow DJ's request to expand knowledge, that knowledge increase from something to something, that life may be enriched. And also his advisory board, who keeps wanting to expand the number of students. And this morning we had an advisory board meeting in which we discussed the complete solving of the organ transplantation problem of access and enough organs. Then we discussed the opening of the Global Health Initiative, leading me to believe that next year we will have an intergalactic ethics program. So I think DJ is very happy with what you've done, Mark. Thank you.
Our third and final reminiscence will be from Joel Howell. Dr. Howell is a professor at the University of Michigan in the Department of Internal Medicine, Health Management and Policy and History, as well as the Victor C. Vaughn Professor of the History of Medicine. He received his MD at the University of Chicago and stayed here for his internship, residency in internal medicine, and a fellowship at the MacLean Center for Clinical Medical Ethics. And maybe we'll get actually a year, so we'll know how many years we really have been doing this. He then went to the University of Pennsylvania, where he was a Robert Wood Johnson Clinical Scholar and received his PhD in the History and Sociology of Science. Dr. Howell has been a faculty member at the University of Michigan since 1984. Please.
I don't know, Mark, I'm learning more about you all the time. It's a really a great honor to be here to help celebrate this occasion for Mark. And obviously, we're going to spend most of the next day and a half talking about the content of his work. I'd like to talk just for a second about the context, to try to historicize the development of the MacLean Center. And I do so because there's a real risk when we look at the world as it exists today of assuming not only that something should exist, but that it was inevitable that it would come into existence. And I don't think that was the case at all. Sometimes the purpose of history is to look at the contingent nature of change, to describe how and why and when certain institutions came into existence, as well as to reconstruct the world of the past, doing so whenever possible, not through the malleable selective omissions and distortions of our own individual memories, but as far as possible using the bread and butter of the historian, which is the primary sources, and I've tried to do that whenever I could. So let's go back to the world of the 1980s. Though it might not be obvious today, I want to emphasize just how profound a disjunction the formation of the MacLean Center was. And the previous speakers have certainly alluded to this and given some background for it. Yes, the Hastings Center had been founded about a decade earlier in 69. Yes, the Kennedy Institute in 71. But I would argue that neither was deeply embedded in the clinical world. Yes, there were ideas about clinical ethics that were out there. There was a conference for the SIBA Foundation Conference on Kidney Transplantation in 66, the Ross Conference on Pediatrics Research in 72, looking at neonatal medicine, and of course the Belmont Report in 77. But these committees were not permanently established. They were not ongoing. They were not reproductive. The overall environment, when you look back, was hardly propitious for the kind of task that Mark undertook. In the early 1980s, wanting permanently and meaningfully to establish clinical ethics within a distinguished department in medical school, Mark, I think you were swimming against a tide, the strength of which is hard to imagine today and impossible fully to explain in my limited time. Only a few decades earlier, funding for basic science had exploded. The NIH, which previously had supported virtually no extramural research, was pouring money into medical centers, both well-established, like the University of Chicago, and others that were relatively new. And Mark, I still remember, I don't know if you remember, when Don Seldon came and gave grand rounds here. And I sat there not far, just across the midway, and you and I together listened to him talk. And what he said, and you allude to this in your paper on the nature and limits of clinical medicine, which is in the selection of readings, what Don Seldon, a very distinguished leader, said, a giant, a lion, he said to me, he said to everybody in the audience, he said, this social cultural stuff, forget it. Your job as a physician is to do science. You deal with science, you deal with disease, you deal with facts, you deal with knowledge. And I say this not to bring out one person, but because he was very much in the majority. And that was the tide against which Mark was swimming. And that's important to realize that now it seems so obvious that we need the MacLean Center. It seems so obvious that we need to consider these issues. It was not obvious then. And I think your story about tenure points out that it wasn't obvious to everybody even here. Now, clinical ethics was out there. It was in the air. And how did Mark make it happen? And I'm going to cut some stuff here because I think that Dr. Tarlov has expressed and others have expressed so eloquently the importance of the clinical side of what Mark did. I just say, I saw this firsthand. You may not remember, but when I was an intern, my very first rotation, you were my attending. And I and everybody else saw this incredible passion and enthusiasm for patient care that others have described better than I could. It also meant that you had not just academic credentials, but deep personal legitimacy, and that, I think, enabled Mark to talk to a wider audience. We do not have included in our readings the op-ed pieces that Mark wrote for the New York Times in the early 1980s. But I want to reflect back on those because I think they're very telling of the kind of person that he was and the fact that he was speaking to a wider audience, not just to a group of academics, but to the country at large. There was one wonderful column in which Mark said, "How can we make physicians more humane?" And he said, and I think you were right, you can't teach people to be humane in medical school. You either are or you're not. So we need to select more humane physicians. And how should we do this? You had a couple of ideas. One was maybe we should have applicants write a book review and then defend it over a beer in a local pub. I suspect you had Jimmy's in mind. I'm not sure. And the other suggestion, I think, that was prescient in the 1980s, in 1982, I believe it was, might not seem that prescient today, but again, in 1982, when there were very few women, at least compared to what there are today in medical school, Mark said one solution is that we should have more women in medical school classes. And I think you're right about that as well. Another op-ed explored several reasons, moral and otherwise, why doctors should provide free health care. So I think this is an example of how he was thinking broadly and engaging a wide-ranging audience. I want to make one more brief historical point. There's an enormous literature in the history of science that looks at which laboratories, which research groups really have an impact and which ones don't. And the ones that have an impact are the ones that are able to reproduce themselves. And so the decision to have a training program at the core of the MacLean Center, I think, is absolutely critical to its success. And this map illustrates the extraordinarily wide sweep and wide scope of the sorts of ideas that you were putting out there in the early 1980s. And I think that this is a very telling and very important lesson. And finally, although my time runneth short, and this isn't really strictly speaking what I was supposed to talk about, I must express my enormous personal respect and gratitude, not just for me, but for a whole cohort of physicians who have worked in the humanities and social sciences. With all the trials and tribulations, Mark, you were the first person to get tenure in a major academic medical center with your research firmly based in the social sciences and humanities. The first one. And so I think that you have served as an exemplar for a whole generation, many of whom are in the audience here, of physicians who have followed in your footsteps. The intellectual rigor of your work and your enormous passion for the subject have helped us all, and I think that all of us, not just patients and not just those people who are at the MacLean Center, but all of us who have tried to work in that area owe you a tremendous depth of gratitude, and I thank you.
We're going to skip forward 20 years, and it's my privilege to introduce our current chairman of the Department of Medicine, Skip Garcia. Dr. Garcia is the Lowell T. Coggeshall Professor and chairman of the department since 2005. He came to us from Johns Hopkins and did his medical degree training at the University of Texas Southwestern Medical School, completing his residency in internal medicine at the University of Iowa Hospitals and a pulmonary fellowship at Albany Medical College. Please help me welcome Dr. Garcia.
Well, thanks a lot, Lainey. Lainey asked me to maybe just say a few words about where the center and our relationship with Mark, where we stand today. And then she will follow this up with some much more detailed comments delineating where the center is in the bigger scope of things. But I do appreciate the opportunity to talk to you all today about Mark and about the center, because obviously this is a tremendous source of pride for our university, but particularly our department. I don't think it's any secret to this audience that the secret of its success has been its focus actually on the real world of medicine and on the real problems that are confronting nurses and physicians who take care of patients both in the outpatient setting, in the hospital, and as we've heard today about the critically ill. Now, I knew that there was a lot of bonds between Mark and myself, but clearly one bond is that I'm an ICU-trained physician, and I was just really excited to understand about how Dr. Tarlov asked Mark to start the first medical ICU in the city of Chicago a while back. And it really resonates with me because of the problems in which Mark encountered in that job, as you've heard from Al and from Ann as well. These are the problems that, you know, in my own career, I've had to grapple with as well. Care of delivery to the critically ill, the end-of-life decisions, the informed consent, the, you know, surrogate decision-making, and of course, as Al very aptly and eloquently delineated, this allocation of very scarce resources for the critically ill. So I know that this helped shape Mark's career in that way, and it, again, just it shows how the breadth of Mark's ability to reach and touch and resonate with so many aspects of our trainees and our faculty is really simply a spectacular issue. Now, at the core, of course, of the where the center is today, you know, it's a spectacular success. It is absolutely, without doubt, a premier medical ethics program in the country, where its flagship, of course, is the fellowship training program. We'll hear more about from Laney. But, you know, the number of trainees that have been through the center, the number of academically intense, over 170 physician trainees in the center that are still academically involved and nationally and internationally acclaimed is just an amazing feat. In our hospital, yeah, we have in the department, you know, lots of awareness of the consultative service that was started by Mark in the center. This is obviously a very unique service that attends and addresses issues for adults and children both, and is coupled very tightly to a multidisciplinary conference, which is, you know, really simply spectacular and the envy of many medical ethics programs around the world. I think that this conference provides a forum for engaging our trainees and our faculty in issues of humanism and the physician-patient relationship in ways that other institutions can only dream about. But I think one of the essential pieces, and I'll just close with this thought, one of the essential pieces of the center and Mark's amazing vision for the center has been its linkage to mentorship. Obviously, we know that the classical three legs of the academic stool are clinical care, research, and education, but that fourth leg is truly mentorship, and Mark has understood that from the very beginning, obviously mentoring a number of you in the audience in ways that are very special to you and to Mark, but as well as to me. As a new chair here at the University of Chicago, Mark was of enormous help and very, very mentorally in his advice and in his ability to be there to help me navigate these difficult problems. But Mark has recognized the need for a structure to the mentorship in the center and has provided a very strong infrastructure in which mentees and fellows are matched to a really amazing diversity of individuals with rich skill sets that include theologians and philosophers, as well as clinicians and lawyers and economists. And I think this really is at the very heart of the success of the program and of its trainees. So in closing, let me just say, as chair of a department that houses the MacLean Center, I am just enormously proud of the accomplishments of the center, and the center continues to bring great pride to our department. But I think one of the early aspects of the success of the center is Mark's vision for reaching out beyond the department to other clinical departments, first pediatrics and then surgery, and now it's fully integrated across the university and bringing this new knowledge and this new expertise to this program. And that really underlies the true brilliance of Mark's leadership of the center. So with that, I'll just close and say thank you, Mark, and it's a great honor to be here to be able to talk about you.
So it's my privilege to give the update of the MacLean Center. So here we are today, a Festschrift in honor of Mark. The center, the MacLean Center today, the center faculty has over 24 physician faculty members. We're supplemented by faculty from philosophy, history, sociology, and the law school. And in fact, in this past year, we have 6 new faculty members. The fellowship, we've trained over 240 fellows, and over 80% remain in academics. 2 new initiatives in the past few years. First is the beginning of a surgical ethics program in 2006. The first of its kind, and in fact, in the last 2 years, we've trained over 12 surgeons, which is more than we had done in the first 18 years. We also have now a new 2 years master's degree program that began in 2005 and have trained 3 fellows to date. Today, there are many ethics programs around the country and around the world, many run by MacLean Center graduates, as I'll be showing. The MacLean Center, however, remains the first and foremost program focused on clinical ethics and the doctor-patient relationship. And the MacLean Center faculty do remain committed to the tripartite mission of the academic medical centers, clinical care, research, and education. So looking at the 3 pillars, in clinical care, we have over 100 clinical ethics consults annually. Our main focus in the recent years has been on end-of-life care and decision-making capacity. We have a weekly ethics consultation service that many of you have attended, which attracts over 50 participants weekly. In research, last year, the faculty and fellows published over 200 articles in the peer-reviewed literature, and we attracted grants from the NIH, nonprofit, as well as local foundations. And on the education component, many of you remember fondly the summer intensive, which continues to exist for five to six weeks with 3 lectures a day, 5 days a week, sort of like the booklets we sent out to you, a little bit too much always. The coursework is scheduled now. For those of you who were here at an earlier time, it's now all compressed into 1 day in order to allow fellows to pursue other training and careers. The current 1-year fellowship this year includes 17 1-year fellows, the largest class ever, which includes 6 surgeons. We also have this year 4 senior fellows and 1 2-year fellow. But let's focus on Mark and his influence, and I want to start with his influence on the clinical ethics community. So one way of thinking about it is 6 degrees of separation with Mark in the center, and look at his influence. So here, just to give an example, are our current 2008-2009 faculty, and what you can see is how many were former fellows, as well as how many are new faculty appointed since 2005. We also, though, have former fellows who have academic achievements around the country. We have 1 dean and president. We have a number of former fellows who have endowed professorships. Here is a list of all the faculty out there. Many of you are here today, and I thank you, who have full professorships. Here are former fellows of the MacLean Center who are or were directors and chairs of ethics-related programs around the world. It's clear that it's all 2 degrees of separation if you know Mark. But let's focus now on Mark and his influence in the peer-reviewed literature. And so this, some of you can go back to the 1970s, but when you go on the computer, you only get articles back to 1989, showing the number of publications that Mark had every year. But more interesting is the number of times these articles have been cited on a yearly basis, with a peak of over 300 citations in the year 2003. But when you think about Mark, you don't think about Mark publishing. You often think about Mark co-publishing with many of his peers. So I want you to all think, who is Mark's most frequent co-author? And the answer is Carol Stocking with 41, John Lantos with 26, Peter Singer with 22. We get into the single digits. We get down to the 3s and the 2s. And then if you go for 1 citation or 1 degree of separation, the slides keep coming. But let's focus on Mark and his influence on the libraries of the world, and I don't mean to suggest the clutter, but I do mean to look at some of the books. First is Clinical Ethics, now in its sixth edition, including the most recent Kindle edition. And then from Mark's colleagues and former fellows, we have books by current MacLean faculty here, and then from books from all of his former fellows and visiting faculty, and again, it goes several pages. So it's an incredible accomplishment. It's one that is a great place to be. We hope you always feel like you can come home. Thank you very much. So it's on those notes that I want to end the reminiscing, at least for today. We'll get to do some more on Saturday morning. What I would like to do, though, is to now begin the substance. And here we'll begin with clinical ethics, the field. We'll look at how it began. And Dr. Pellegrino promises me he's taking it back much before 1990, but we're going to look at then and clinical ethics, the field, in the current. So let me begin by introducing Dr. Ed Pellegrino, who since 2005 has been the chair of the President's Bioethics Council. Dr. Pellegrino is Professor Emeritus of Medicine and Medical Ethics at the Center for Clinical Medical Ethics at Georgetown University Medical Center, where he was the John Carroll Professor of Medicine and Medical Ethics, and the former director of the Kennedy Institute of Ethics, the Center for the Advanced Study of Ethics, the Center for Clinical Bioethics, and an adjunct professor of philosophy, all at Georgetown University. He has also, though, served as president of Catholic University, president and chairman of the Yale New Haven Medical Center, chancellor and vice president of health affairs at the University of Tennessee, founding chairman of the Department of Medicine at the University of Kentucky, dean of the School of Medicine at the State University of New York in Stony Brook, and founder of the Health Sciences Center there. Please help me welcome Dr. Pellegrino.
Thank you very much, Lady. It's a real privilege to be here. For me, it's almost as Yogi Berra would have said, deja vu all over again, because just a few years ago, I had the privilege of delivering the MacLean anniversary lecture in honor of our honoree today. In the years since then, my admiration over all of these years has been growing by leaps and bounds. There's every sign, and you've seen those signs numerically portrayed, that Mark's trajectory of success will continue. His place in the history of bioethics is secure. As a result of Mark's work and Mark's students and the MacLean Center, the University of Chicago has really become the preeminent locus nationally and internationally for training, research, and practice in clinical ethics. And the centerpiece of Mark's work, and the one I think which he will be most often mentioned and praised in the years ahead, is his interest in the physician-patient relationship, the clinical encounter, a situation in which a person seeking assistance comes to a physician, trusting and hoping, and that's a moment that will happen to each and every one of us, and it's a moment which Mark has done so much to illuminate. It's at the central, the moral center of clinical ethics, indeed, of medical ethics entirely. And I think what I would like to do this afternoon is take a little liberty with the question of the then and talk a little bit about the perceptions of the physician-patient relationship, what they were like when Mark entered the field. As you can gather, I have a few years on Mark, and so I was there, but I'm not going to be talking about my experiences, but rather the situation that he entered, because you've heard a great deal about how he has changed that facet of medicine, the physician-patient encounter and relationship. So allow me a few moments. But before doing that, let me say I first met Mark when I was the chairman of the Institute on Human Values in Medicine, of the National Academy of Sciences as internal medicine, and also of the National Endowment for the Humanities. And we had 77 fellows, and I used to meet with those fellows from time to time. I first met Mark in one of those meetings, and immediately he impressed himself upon all of us with his imagination, with his vigor, with his sonorous voice, with his takeover of the conversation. And I say that in a very positive sense of the word. Mark, you really did strike us as a promising physician for the future, those of us who were old enough to have had a little bit of past. But that program attracted very many young physicians, 77 of them, as a matter of fact. And I would say that, without making comparisons, that Mark certainly was among those who profited most from the basic idea behind that institute, which was to provide an opportunity for a crossover between physicians, young physicians, who are interested in the humanities specifically, not so much ethics as ethics, but the humanities and human values. Those are the two terms we used mostly in those days. And with the humanists who were interested in medicine. And what the program did was provide an opportunity in the summer for each to spend time in the other's purview. And I think, Mark, that you profited by that. You brought a great deal to it, but I think it provided a substance to what you were doing, a support, a notion that this might be something worthwhile. And as Dr. Tarloff said, you were shocked by the choice of this particular pursuit in medicine. And there were a number of young people at that time, but they needed support and sustenance. And I think the National Endowment for the Humanities should get some credit for that. Now, you know what's come out of Mark's interest. It's been related to you in much greater detail than I can possibly do. But I would like to suggest three of these, which I think are most significant, having worked in bioethics for a little bit of time. One surely is the fellowship program. And certainly the way to change a field is to train young people. Train young people and plant them in academic centers so they can be the viruses, so to speak, who would change the DNA of those particular institutions. You have certainly changed the DNA to a certain extent, I'm sure, to put it very mildly, here at Chicago. But those you've taught have gone on around the country and have advanced the whole notion of the humanities in medicine, out of which, incidentally, when the history is written, the movement of medical ethics and teaching of medical ethics did grow. A second most important aspect of Mark's work is the grounding of clinical ethics in a firm conceptual and empirical foundation. As I will say in a few moments and explain a little bit of how it was before, Mark didn't do all of this, I know he would agree with you, but this was the kind of thing he would be dealing with and perceiving what was missing. And the third is, without any question, the fact that while pursuing his scholarly work, Mark continued to be a bona fide physician. That is a source of verisimilitude, a source of verification of what one is saying clinically, that isn't always a part of the teaching of clinical ethics. All these three actions on Mark's part played a role that's most unusual in changing our notions of what the clinical encounter was. Encounter is a bad word, but the relationship, as I said, between a person who was ill, the time that comes that one is vulnerable, dependent, and anxious, and that's what caught Mark's heart. How do I bring contemporary medicine in that relationship? Let me turn then just a little bit to the then. I asked Dr. Lanny Ross to tell me what she meant by then, and she said, well, you'll have to interpret this rather freely. So I did do so. And I'm going to say a few words about how the clinical encounter was envisioned 4 or 5 years or more before you got into it, namely in 1965. Not to praise it, please. This is not an elderly gentleman telling you how great it was in those days, not at all. Rather, to tell you that the concept, the perception of what it was to be with a physician and to meet a physician was different than it is today. And to a certain extent, that doesn't mean that everything that's changed is good or everything that is new is bad, but only that we have had a continuation, a continuous thread, and it is with this thread of clinical medicine that Mark made his major contribution. William Faulkner once said that the past is never dead. Indeed, it's never past. And that's the theme I'd like you to keep in your mind as I say a little bit about how it looked then. America underwent a social revolution in the mid-1960s. I'm not going to give you the history of that revolution, but it challenged every received notion from the past, religious, moral, cultural. Within that was particularly a challenge to all received authority, including professional authority. Before that occurred, and that's what I'm going to be talking about, that slice of time, very, very quickly, there was a more or less unified perspective in America on religious values, cultural values, and so on. And these were redefined because in the medical context, they challenged really what it was to be a human being, what it was to be ill, what it was to have the experience of illness, and what it was to be a healer. In days past, we could think in terms of the physician as an authoritarian father, a brother, a friend, as Seneca called him. Someone, though, who was at a distance from the patient, who was empowered to make apodictic statements about what was right and what was wrong. Allegiance was expressed almost universally to the Hippocratic corpus and oath, even though it wasn't practiced. Many of these things were not practiced, but there was a general nimbus of ideas and ideals which rested on the whole profession. A different kind of relationship. Patients spoke of my doctor, and doctors spoke of my patient, a sense of mutuality that had a very great importance to both members. The idea of the physician asking the patient what he would like or she would like to have done didn't exist. The patient didn't understand how it could work in the first place. He came to the doctor, he thought, to be helped. Now, I'm not suggesting physicians faithfully followed all these ideals, but it was the framework, the social matrix, within which that relationship was conducted. Some of us, Mark certainly, some others of us as well, felt that this was something that had to change, given the time that we're in. We're no longer in a time when clinical decisions and professional relationships were dictated by long traditions of the past. We entered an era in which everything was challenged, including for physicians, the revered Hippocratic Oath. Remember now, none of these statements are value statements on my part. They're simply descriptions of where we were. And one had to then think about how does one reconstruct the fidelity relationship, the situation in which a patient is forced to trust in a physician-patient relationship in which the power is on the side of the patient. How does one deal with that? Mark suggested the negotiated relationship. Clinical ethics, especially professional ethics, was situated within a communal agreement on certain things which ought not to be done. This, such things as the sharing and splitting of fees, infraction of the ethics of consultation, conflicts of interest, financial interest, collusion with pharmaceutical companies, crackpot panaceas, association with persons of physician or unsavory character. Those were things that defined the area one ought not ever to mention. Again, this does not mean, I want to insist on that fact, that there were not physicians who practiced all of these irregular and borderline activities. What it does mean, however, that physicians did not justify those marginal practices. Somewhere, somehow, there had to be a foundation put into the relationship so that even if one did not share the same values with the patient or with the society, one could enter into a human relationship, a relationship of equality, of equal dignity. I'm often asked to compare today's physicians and medical students with those of my time, the 40s, and people assume that physicians and students were of better character and their personal ethics was of a higher order. I am most emphatically opposed to that position. Medical students today, as they have always been, are a biopsy of humanity, of the American people, with good and bad intermingled, and it will always be that way. But what the kind of movement that Mark has been involved in has done has to raise sensitivities to the point that even those who were on this margin of things that were not entirely acceptable began to feel more and more uncomfortable about moving into those areas. I think Mark would not want me to say that he has single-handedly changed all of this, but all of his work, as you can see, his published work, his work with his own students and residents, above all, his example, which, by the way, is the only way to teach medical ethics, by the example of a respected clinical teacher. This is not to depreciate those who are not physicians. Please do not make that inference either. It's merely to say that we need some small cadre of persons who have a knowledge of medical ethics and also have a knowledge of the interstices of that relationship. And I'll simply close by saying that Mark understood what, interestingly, a poet, John Keats, said about philosophy. He said that axioms in philosophy do not become axioms until we feel them on our pulses. And I think that as a teacher, Mark, what you have done is helped your students feel on their pulses the experience of the patient. I close merely by saying that over and over again when I ask my patients, what should I tell these young residents? What is the most important message that I can give them? And they say over and over and over again, tell them, please, to feel something of our experience, to feel that they're in our place. The way I like to put it today is, help your students to feel that they are on the gurney and that they're in a position of dependence and uncertainty and anxiety, and that the physician, the most important thing about the physician after his technical capability, is his character. And Mark, that's the tribute that I would pay to you, that your character, your virtues as a human being and as a physician are the message that you have given. Thank you.
So we're going to fast forward and have Peter Singer talk about clinical ethics, the field today. And then at the end, we'll have Dr. Pellegrino and Dr. Singer both take questions. Peter Singer, one of the co-organizers of the conference, is a senior scientist and professor of medicine at the McLaughlin Rotman Center for Global Health at the University Health Network and University of Toronto. Peter Singer is a member of the Scientific Advisory Board of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation Grand Challenges for Global Health Initiative, a former member of the U.S. National Academies Committee, which reported on globalization, biosecurity, and the future of life sciences, and he has advised the U.N. Secretary's General Office on biosecurity. Between 1995 and 2006, Peter was the Sun Life Financial Chair in Bioethics, Director of the World Health Organization Collaborating Center for Bioethics at the University of Toronto, and Director of the University of Toronto Joint Center for Bioethics. Peter studied internal medicine at the University of Toronto, medical ethics at the MacLean Center for Clinical Medical Ethics at the University of Chicago, public health at Yale University, and management at Harvard Business School. Let us welcome Peter Singer.
Thank you very much. It really is a great honor to be here and a great pleasure to be here with you, Mark, and all these people who admire and adore you so much. It's great to be a part of it. You know, I was never a huge fan of tenure, and I think after those stories we heard today, I mean, is that not the most compelling argument against tenure one's ever heard? And just imagine if all that work that went into promotion and tenure was actually put to some productive use. In any event, today we're very happy here to be having a Festschrift for Mark Siegler. So just raise your hand if you know what the hell a Festschrift is. Yeah, so about a third of the people do. One of the early originators of the idea here was Martin McNeely, who's here in the audience. And when he first mentioned it to me, I wasn't sure either. I looked it up on the dictionary on the web, and a Festschrift turns out is a volume of articles, essays, etc., contributed by many authors in honor of a colleague, usually published on the occasion of retirement. Are you retiring, Mark? No? Okay. Or another important anniversary, I guess the 25th anniversary, or another important anniversary. So I won't tell you about the other definition in Merriam-Webster's, which said that usually it was in memory of someone. They clearly got it wrong. On the other hand, though, on Wikipedia, it tells us that one scholar actually said, quote, a Festschrift frequently enough also serves as a convenient place in which those who are invited to contribute find a permanent resting place for their otherwise unpublishable or at least difficult to publish papers. Now, keeping that in mind, and keeping in mind the definition focused on this volume but with a penumbra of celebration around it, what I would like to suggest is during these proceedings, we focus a little bit more on the fest and a little bit less on the shrift. I want to speak briefly about clinical ethics now, and I've entitled my talk The Mark Siegler Effect, and as anyone who has come even within 15 degrees of separation of Mark knows, he's really a force of nature. I just wanted to start, before getting into some a bit more substantive stuff, with three early memories. I was in the 1980s, early 1980s, a medical student, really trying to find my way. I was interested in both the clinical and scientific side and the humanistic side. And I would say when I first read A Legacy of Osler, which was really, along with Dr. Pellegrino's Moment of Clinical Truth, one of the two core inspirational pieces for physicians, really changed my life. I became very interested in this field before there really even was a field of clinical ethics. I first met Mark in 1985. I distinctly remember a time when we were driving along in Toronto, and we were just discussing the opportunity for me to come here a year or so after that. And I was really surprised at the time. Mark started asking questions about my mother, my girlfriend, and of course what he was doing was looking to see how easy it would be to move, and whether, even for a year, and whether someone is coming here or more apposite, when people are leaving here. I think anyone who's passed through here knows very much about Mark's personal involvement in recruitment and placement issues, which I actually found extremely unusual and very endearing. When we first came back to Toronto together, we gave grand rounds together at one of the hospitals, and that was actually also the first time I met my wife. So in a sense, Mark introduced me to my wife. She was sitting in the audience. Mark was giving a talk. She was sitting next to someone who had done their internship with me, and my wife leaned over and said, "What's he like?" And she said, "Oh, you got to stay away from him. He's a jerk." So Mark, in summary, for these and very many other reasons, has really changed my life. And that's the quickest way to summarize it. But what I want you to reflect on is, has he changed yours? Because I bet you, for most people in the room, and I'm sure some of these stories will come out, the answer to that is yes. And I really look forward to hearing those stories, because I think in the long term, I'll come back to this in a second, that's a huge part of the legacy, the influence you've had on people's lives, Mark. And for that, we all thank you very, very much. Now, as many of you know, Ed Pellegrino, Mark, and I have a decennial hobby. That's every 10 years. Which is to survey the field of clinical ethics. And the two of the papers are in your booklet. The first one was published in 1990 in the first issue of the Journal of Clinical Ethics, and that reviewed the previous decade from 1980 to 1990 of clinical medical ethics. And the second paper, the one I want to focus on in this talk, was published in 2001 January, so let's say very close to 2000, and it reviewed the second decade of clinical ethics. And what we're talking about here is clinical ethics in 2010, and what I want to ask is, maybe this is a warm-up, so maybe you guys want to think about we do this again in 2010, and what I'd like to ask everyone in the room is to please email me any thoughts or comments you have. I'll share some early thoughts about the field, but I'd be very interested in your thoughts and comments, particularly where you think I get it wrong. And there's my email address, and you can raise hell in the discussion period or email me later, and maybe we'll use this to feed into another one of these in 2010 with these guys here. So as you know, those papers are divided into four parts: research, teaching, clinical ethics, which we called ethics committees and consults, and the future of clinical medical ethics. And what I've done on the next eight slides is I've put what we had as the remaining challenges in 2001 on the first slide of a couplet, and then some early reflections about the field on the second slide of a couplet, which is really where I'd be looking for your input. So in 2001, we said that some remaining challenges were research in clinical ethics needed to become a mainstream concern for funding agencies, that there was more evidence-based ethics research needed and less commentary, that ethics journals had low impact and weren't read by health workers, that more interdisciplinary and interprofessional research was needed, and that capacity building in clinical ethics research was required. Now, in terms of research in clinical ethics, you do have some important papers. I did a little search, not as sophisticated as Laney, but actually the top cited paper since 2000 has been this paper by Zeke Emanuel and colleagues on what makes clinical ethics, what makes clinical research ethical, with 340 citations, which is getting into the mainstream of well-cited papers, but not yet like a method like SDS, polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis. Ethics, I think, has moved into the funding and journal mainstream. and there's lots of capacity for research. There's lots of ethics groups with sort of millions of dollars of peer-reviewed funding, lots of articles in mainstream journals. That, I think, has been accomplished. There are still 10 relatively low-impact medical ethics journals, but open access in terms of journals has made a big difference on distribution. Just as an example, that Clinical Ethics Revisited paper from 2001 I mentioned was the fourth most accessed paper ever in that journal with over 22,000 accesses. So that's what open access has done really to journal publishing, even in medical ethics. I fear that we're at the same level of interdisciplinary and interprofessional research, and there's still some stuff we can do there. And there is still much more opinion than evidence in the corpus of medical ethics scholarship. And finally, I'd like to say that there's not, in my view, a serious commitment to using research results to improve the patient experience. And I just want to pose this as a hypothesis, and I want to ask you, what is the groundbreaking finding in the last 10 years in the field of clinical medical ethics that's been published that really has had major patient care implications and changed patient care? I'm open to suggestion here, but in other fields like cardiology or neurology, you could point to two or three really groundbreaking things that have made major changes for patients. And I think we're not quite there yet, but I'd be interested in anyone's other views in the discussion. In the area of teaching, in 2001, we said the remaining challenges were internet-based teaching modules needed to increase dissemination of knowledge. We talked about the incorporation of continuing health education, continuing medical education, effective practices, including for bedside teaching. We spoke of the need to harness the informal curriculum to develop an ethics-focused culture. We said that there ought to be more attention to character formation and role modeling, which I think we also said 10 years before. A greater focus on evaluation and a need to strengthen capacity to teach ethics, especially at the bedside. Now, in terms of teaching clinical ethics, the hypotheses I want to share is there's lots of internet-based teaching and capacity building, and this graph, the slides that Lainey showed, are really the primum inter pares example of that. But I fear there's not been much progress on incorporating best practices of continuing health education, character formation, role modeling, and in particular, harnessing the informal curriculum to change the culture of medicine, or evaluation of bedside ethics skills of students and physicians. And I think that nexus of things, which is all very closely related, is the unfinished agenda. And again, very open to counterfactual examples that can be used to modify these tentative conclusions. In terms of ethics committees and consults, we said the remaining challenges were to integrate those functions into the quality improvement culture of healthcare organizations. We said there was a need to develop accountability frameworks for ethics in healthcare organizations. Systematic strategies needed to be built for ethics capacity among staff in healthcare organizations. We called for the further development of organizational ethics and the need to demonstrate that improvement in patients' outcomes were related to clinical ethics activity in a healthcare facility. Ethics committees and consults, or clinical ethics now, if you will, has made a lot of progress. Just to start with the second point, you know, the accreditation standards in US and Canadian accreditation standards very heavily rely on ethics. I'd ask if the best practices are being shared, but there's been a lot of movement there. Quality and ethics, though, are still not fully aligned. Our mainstream ethics culture, I fear, especially beyond the walls of the MacLean Center, is still critical and therefore not improvement-oriented. It's a lot easier to criticize something than to fix something. And I fear that that's the prevailing and predominant culture of much of bioethics. Criticism is extremely important, especially in scholarship. Don't get me wrong. But there's also a need to roll up your sleeves, work within institutions, think that the perfect shouldn't be the enemy of the good, and fix the real patient care problems that you see. And I think we're just at the tipping point of that becoming the prevailing culture. But I don't think we're there yet. And I think that if and when we do get there, a lot of the credit for that will go to the seeds, Mark, that you sowed, and that's so critically important for patients. organizational ethics has developed. There are some excellent systematic strategies developing for ethics in healthcare organizations, like the VA, like our own joint center. And these are very well described by Sue, by Ellen, by others in the Cambridge textbook of bioethics in their chapter on health systems. I think the main unfinished agenda, though, is something I'd like to call the Sue McRae agenda. For about 10 years, or 15 years, or maybe 20 years, Sue McRae, who's also a graduate of this center, has been arguing for integrating patient and family experience and narratives into clinical ethics, and really using that as the intellectual backbone, if you will, of clinical ethics, and using clinical ethics almost as a conduit to feed those real narratives back to healthcare workers. I think there's some writing about that, but I don't really think that that transformation has yet occurred, and that, I think, is another piece of the unfinished agenda. The future directions piece in 2001, we pointed to the main piece of unfinished business as being the inequities in global health. And we said at that time in 2001, quote, when we revisit clinical ethics a decade from now, we hope to be telling you about the World Health Report on Global Health Ethics written in 2006. The report will address important global issues in bioethics. We went on to say beyond research ethics, which had already been relatively well globalized, in part and largely due to the efforts of Bob Levine and others who are here in the audience. Now, though, ethics has been globalized beyond research ethics. There's a lot of stuff written in global health ethics, and I was so pleased to hear about the initiative from Ann Dudley that you're launching. Sadly, the inequities are the same or worse as the result of HIV and AIDS largely. So if you just think about it, the chance that one of your children will live, the estimated life expectancy of one of your children is about 80 years and rising. The estimated life expectancy in sub-Saharan Africa as a whole is 46 years and falling, and there's a number of countries where it's in the 30s. And if that isn't the mother of all ethical challenges, I don't know what is. So it's fantastic that we've started seeing writing about it, but I think, Mark, bringing the sort of transformational action that you've had in clinical ethics to that sphere will be extremely important. So let me explore for a moment why we haven't made more progress about the inequities themselves. Maybe we just need more time on this agenda. It takes a long time, unfortunately, to change things. Bioethics has become the mainstream in politics, not always for the good, but sometimes for the good in the US, but not elsewhere. Ethics needs to work better with other disciplines because the solutions are holistic. And I think there's also an issue around the private sector. The private sector matters, and we probably should stop demonizing it as an ideological matter, although there's often specific issues for criticism in public and private institutions. So there's just some reflections, and I'm going a bit out on a limb on some of them, and I'm inviting any sort of pushback. But I think that this still is the main piece of unfinished business for bioethics looking forward. So what I've done is just very quickly tried to get an overview of clinical ethics now, using the lens of what we wrote 10 years ago, updating it really with what is not much more than opinion. And I'd really love it if that opinion could be vetted and become almost a type of collective opinion of this group through your pushing back or shaping or influencing any of those ideas. And as I say, maybe we can use that input that we get to do it again before either of you guys retire, although I know that's probably pretty far off for both of you. I just want to end with a tribute to Mark and to Anna, because of course, and I'm sure we'll hear this a lot, the influence of one's family, not just Anna, but all of your children, Mark, and your parents and so on, the influence of one's family is extremely important in allowing one the time, the space, the energy, and the support to do this. And in Anna's case, she actually helped in far more direct ways many, many times. In doing this tribute, I just want to reflect on what Mark's real legacy is. Is it the booklet full of ideas that you're so enthusiastically clutching in your hand in terms of his great papers? Is it this room full of wonderful and talented people? Just look for a moment to your left, look for a moment to your right, and just have a feel of what fantastic people in the room. Is it the field, that's full of both these ideas and these people? You know, if you Google clinical ethics, you get 757,000 hits, and the top entry is Mark's book, Clinical Ethics. If there were a Nobel Prize in ethics, which of course there isn't, the citation would read, Mark Siegler created the field of clinical ethics. So Mark, on behalf of all of us, and we'll have many chances, I think, to celebrate you, I just want to say, on behalf of all of us, we thank you very, very deeply and very, very much. Thank you.
I think that's a really very good question. Thank you for it. Let me take a stab at it, and then let me ask Dr. Pellegrino to respond too, because Dr. Pellegrino really is the father, if you allow me to say so, of bringing philosophical reflection, deep foundational principles into the field of medical ethics. So we may have slightly different views. We'll have to find a balance. But what I would say in response to your question is that I think what one needs is a balance. You know, if you search ethics articles, you'll find that, and I haven't done this lately, but you'll find that about 90% of them are opinion and 10% of them are evidence. I'm actually not arguing that 100% of them or maybe even 50% of them should be about evidence. I just think one needs a slightly better balance. And in fact, you know, one of the great things about clinical ethics is the opportunity to go back and forth from the normative world to the empirical world, almost, you know, as Rawls, in terms of wide reflective equilibrium. And so I think we're limited in terms of the base of evidence that we can go back and forth to, and that's all I'm really saying, not imposing an evidentiary standard on philosophical or legal scholarship or even opinion and commentary, which is so important. Really just striking a balance to make that going back and forth between the normative world and the empirical world a more fulsome enterprise. I don't know, Dr. Pellegrino, if you'd agree or disagree with that, but this is your bag, so far away.
Well, I agree in part, but I do have a slight difficulty, as you suggested. I don't think that dichotomy that's been suggested between the empirical and the conceptual is a real one. I think you must have both. In my own looking at the physician-patient interaction or encounter, as you were kind of say, the moment of clinical truth, there has to be a balance between the experience, I touched on it only briefly in my talk, the experience of illness and the experience of healing and what it is to be someone who is ill. That's often forgotten. That doesn't mean that we shouldn't put the maximum effort we can into the technological dimensions of medicine. But nonetheless, in the long run, we're talking about a human being going through a predicament, and illness is a predicament. So in my own approach to it, I always start with the phenomena of illness and the phenomena of approaching a patient and the phenomenon of offering oneself as a healer in that first moment of the relationship. Out of that, I draw a concept. So I believe you start with the empirical and then you reflect on it in a critical way and you abstract from that what it is. Now that's a very classical and ancient way of thinking about things philosophically, not very popular with many people today. But I think if you reflect on it, you cannot either derive a good notion of what it's about without looking at the experience, nor can you universalize that experience unless you step back and reflect, what is it, what makes it what it is, what makes it different, what makes clinical medicine a kind of human activity which has its own internal morality. Now that's a very, very argumentative statement and not many people agree with me, but that is what Peter's referring to.
Bob? No, but here comes the mic.
Thank you. These are two excellent provocative talks. Thank you. I want to ask Peter.
This works too? Oh, yeah. Wow. I want to ask Peter if he could tell us in his call for evidence that clinical ethics and its teaching and practice has a good effect on patient outcomes. I would like to know how we could go about measuring that.
That's a really insightful question, and I don't have a glib answer or an easy answer, but this is a good opportunity to say, when I'm talking about evidence, and I know also this, when Dr. Pellegrino is talking about evidence, we're not talking about quantitative clinical trials alone or quantitative research alone. We're talking about the full spectrum of evidence from quantitative to qualitative research, sociological studies, narratives of experience, and so on, which is where I think our views join. I would just say, by way of personal reflection, I was trained as a quantitative clinical epidemiologist by Alvin Feinstein, and I found over time I was doing more and more research using qualitative methods, eventually settling on case studies. Now, those case studies are pretty close to the narratives of clinical experience I was referring to in relationship to the SUMA-CREA agenda. So it is a piece of research to find those narratives, feed them back, and judge the effectiveness of those in an evaluation framework that valorizes and values soft, what Alvin used to call soft, so or sociological or qualitative outcomes. That's not a full answer to your question, but it gives you a flavor of where I'm coming from. And I also think probably where Dr. Pellegrino is coming from. I would just say that there's also on the other side, gets back to your question a little bit as well, you know, you can cite examples of large-scale, expensive pieces of quantitative research in bioethics that didn't really help the field that much. And, you know, for me, and I'm sorry if I'm saying the wrong thing here, the support study is not a bad example of that. In some ways, it was extremely important because it was a large randomized trial effort in end-of-life care, and that was extremely important. In some ways, by looking primarily or only at quantitative outcomes, that study found what you'd expect to find, a negative trial, because it wasn't looking for the right outcome. So if you will, pseudo-quantification can also backfire. And sorry if I'm, you know, there's a lot of great things about the support study, and it really is an iconic trial in medical ethics, but I think there's also valid critique around the types of outcomes that were measured that's a relevant example to the discussion that we're having.
Bob wants to ask you a further question.
Just a quick response. I'm very glad to hear Peter's response to my question. The footnote to his response is that all people involved in this negative study showing no effect of advanced directives are still engaged in getting advanced directives, and so am I. So that tells us something about the field.
Yeah, well put.
About the limitations of the empirical approach.
of quantifying things that should have been dealt with more qualitatively.
Yeah, and I want to say, I'll stop in a second, Bill, but I just want to add to it. I agree with Peter's early response to you, and I think some things simply are not measurable in positivistic terms, and I think that's the dilemma and the delusion of scientism. To apply the scientific method, something is not susceptible to it. Aristotle pointed that out a very long time ago. So I think we need really to get a balance. But there are forms of knowledge that we use that are not necessarily logico-deductive. I can't spend a lot of time on that now, but I would mention a number of contemporary philosophers have gone that way with considerable productivity. Excuse me, Bill.
Professor May.
Your use of the contrast of opinion and evidence-based research is categorically dismissive because the whole movement in philosophy, in part, is to move from opinion to judgment. And what you're talking about in that arena of mere opinion is engaged in something more serious. And I noticed Ed Pellegrino did not pick up on your contrast of opinion and evidence-based research, but substituted the word conceptual, which suggests that something more significant is going on than merely the thrashing about in opinions.
Yeah, it's a very helpful comment. Thank you. And it actually lets me qualify what I was saying and what I mean by opinion. What I mean by opinion is not serious scholarship in philosophy, in religion, in law, which has its own set of quality standards. One wouldn't quite, I don't know if one would call them evidentiary standards, but certainly quality standards. That's not what I mean by opinion. What I mean by opinion, and I referenced it in the sort of Medline searches, if you will, of medical ethics in the medical literature, is the commentary format, something that might count as a commentary in Lancet, a policy forum in Science, a sounding board in the New England Journal. And you're very right, and when we write this up, we have to qualify what we mean by opinion. Now, even those can, at times, be quite rigorous and philosophically informed. One of the great examples, present company excluded, Professor May, I won't cite your work, which I think gives a lot of good examples of this as well, but one of the great examples is the commentary written by Dennis Thompson on understanding conflicts of interest in the New England Journal. That's, if you will, in the commentary opinion format, but brought a serious philosophical framework to the exercise. So in summary, I'm not at all intending to be dismissive of serious scholarship in law, in philosophy, or any discipline with deep scholarly roots and strong intellectual standards. What I'm really saying in a very limited way is when you do a medical ethics, as many of the clinical fellows here often do, and you look at some medical ethics topic, 90% of it is sounding board, 10% of it is empirical evidence-based, quantitative or qualitative, and I think that balance could change. And by the way, I think the balance on the opinion side could also shift a little bit more towards a more sophisticated blending of the philosophical, legal, and other normative approaches and religious studies approaches with the standard format of commentaries that don't always show what their fundamental scholarly base might be for their argument.
I don't wanna...
Do you agree with that or disagree? Well, that's progress compared to where you started with your question, so thank God.
That's a good diplomatic statement, Bill.
I think he's being sincere, right?
Yeah. Well, I'd like to just add on the matter of point. Opinion is a proposition. It's the beginning of a dialectic. It is not the conclusion. And it is not necessarily one that has to be subjected to empirical evidence. And there are a lot of things. I think that's one of the problems we're having in medical ethics today is that people are trying to empiricize what, it's a bad word, what is not subjected to that possibility. I want to just quote Aristotle. He said that the educated man does not look for precision in an experience which does not render itself to that kind of examination. So opinion is valid, the beginning of dialectic. But it's the dialectic and carried out in a very orderly and systematic way, which I think I'm talking about anyway.
Yeah, what he said.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Pellegrino and Singer.